with that, it is my pleasure to introduce our next speaker of the session, Professor Bram van der Borg from Vrije University in Brussels, where he leads numerous projects, including the Homo Roboticus project and many other European-funded projects. I would like to point out that for 5 years, he was also a research director at the Babeș-Bolyai University in my native Romania. So it gives me a great pleasure to plug that. I'm sure many of you know him as the editor-in-chief of our beloved IEEE Robotics and Automation magazine. And with that, Professor van der Borg, can you please take over?
Yes, thank you for the kind introduction. And indeed, I will talk about using locking and redundant mechanisms for more energy efficient actuation. And I'm a part of the VEB Robotics, but I'm also core lab manager of Flanders Make, which is a research institute to support the Flemish manufacturing industry. And so the motivation of our work is the videos that we all know. And so the most of our applications are turned around human-robot interaction for applications in health and manufacturing. But as you can see, the human body is capable of many impressive things that I'm not able to do what those people on the video can do. But it gives us a lot of inspiration for more natural and safe and energy efficient actuation. Because if you compare electric motors and muscles from a first view, electric motors outperform the human muscles, say their power to mass ratio is 10 times higher than the human muscles, and also the maximum efficiency is higher. And that is then in strange contrast with the fact that usually the cost for energy to transport a robot and to walk and so on is 10 times higher for a robot, and that the payload to mass ratio is also often 10 times higher than a human. So we still have huge problems in the activation of our robots to make them as performant as our human muscles and how we're implemented. And so one of the important aspects is that there is the activator efficiency map, and the maximum efficiency is pretty good, 65%, but it's in only a very narrow region. And so that works well for systems like pumps that can always work at nominal conditions. But we usually in our robots, let them work at high torques and low speeds, and also at high speeds with low torque. So in fact, we use the complete area of the motors, and you see there is a lot of blue area in it, which means that there is there where there is a very low energy efficiency. So that means that most of the time our motors are just producing heat instead of providing mechanical power. And so what are mechanisms to go around that, to especially make mobile applications like exoskeletons and prostheses more energy efficient? So at the very beginning of our research, we were implementing like several compliant elements, and because they could store and release energy in their motion to make, for example, this pendulum motion more energy efficient. And at the very start, also in my PhD, we only considered the mechanical energy domain. But in fact, for electric motors, as we saw on the previous graph, this is not sufficient. And this is, for example, work of our colleague Tonga Strat, who recently became a professor. And you see, when you have the mechanical energy map for parallel elastic activation or for series elastic activation for such a kind of pendulum motion, that you see that the energy efficiency map changes when you start to only have from the mechanical domain, so only have the spring element there. But if you also consider the model of the energy efficiency from the motor and the gearbox in it, it becomes much more different. And so that means that when you study energy efficiency, it's important to consider the whole drivetrain of the system, and that's not sufficiently alone to only consider the mechanical energy consumption. So Tom wrote several publications from this. So the idea to develop robots with variable stiffness actuators or series elastic actuator was performed in several robots, and so both using pneumatic muscles, and this is a pleated pneumatic muscle, which is a bit different than the McKibben muscle because it can provide higher torques at lower pressures and also doesn't suffer so much from hysteresis. And this is, for example, exoskeletons which were built in the MIRAD project, for example, for assistance, but also variable stiffness actuators here implemented in a step rehabilitation robot. We also develop social robots with them, which we tested, for example, with children with autism. And we're happy to see that they're also gradually going towards commercial robots, like, for example, the famous Baxter robots, which implement the series elastic actuator. And so we do a lot of projects with companies in order, for example, to improve the ergonomics programming by user demonstration and so on. So more going towards the end application of it. So we wrote a review paper already a while ago on the different mechanisms in order to obtain variable impedance or variable stiffness. And so there is a whole zoo in the meantime of different variable impedance actuators developed, which all have their particularities. Some are very can store quite a lot of energy. Others can without a lot of energy change the stiffness, for example. So depending on your application needs, it makes the case to choose a particular topology and mechanism in order to realize your variable stiffness. So more info is in this review paper. But that we saw that it was also not sufficient, and that still you have the electric motor and you have the load. And that, of course, a spring element can make that energy is exchanged between the environment and the spring, but that still all the torques will go through your motor, and as such, that loads the motor. And when there is a load on the motor, that also means that there is an electrical energy consumption. Even if the motor is standing still, there is mechanically no power used, but there is electrical power consumed just to keep that force there. So also a robot holding a certain weight, that means that all that that energy is consumed to keep that weight in that position. So that's why the group started to look into locking mechanisms, and locking mechanisms are very old. So it's a very old technology, locking mechanisms, but I think they again become very relevant in our robotic applications. And also, again, with the same as the variable stiffness actuators, there are a lot of principles how you can obtain locking mechanisms. Moreover, you have passive and also active activation of it. And what we did in this review paper published in the magazine is to make a kind of few questions that you need to ask yourself, and that where the answers, depending on your application, lead to one or more optimal, or what we think optimal, locking principles. And so, do you need an adjustable locking torque? Do you need to lock and unlock under load, for example? How many locking positions do you need? Is power consumption of your locking mechanism critical, and so on? So with answering a few questions, we direct the reader towards a kind of optimal for that application locking mechanism. And you see different applications already starting to use those locking mechanisms. And we, for example, needed locking mechanisms to make our prosthetic feet much more energy efficient, because the requirements of prostheses are very stringent. And to give you an idea, we need about 120 Newton meter of torque. Placing two boxes of beers on your hand, that's the torque in your shoulder to walk. Moreover, you need to a few hundred watts of energy burst. So if you want to do that with a classical electric motor, you really need a very big motor for that, which makes that your prosthesis so heavy that it's not very interesting. So what we started to do, we have to look to the ankle turf characteristic, which is often done, and you see it goes from initial contact to flat feet to heel off and to toe off. And hold this energy is a positive loop, so you need to implement energy. But or you do it with a classical motor, and that means braking and then releasing energy. All this area under this curve, you can store in a spring, and that's what we do. But we also added an additional mechanism, because otherwise you go from initial contact to flat feet, right, to this position and then like that, and you miss the gray part. So we implemented an overrunning clutch, which we can reset, and that was a patent that we took in order to also take that gray area. And one of the big advantages of this mechanism is as well that whatever position the foot lands, that at that moment the foot automatically adapts to different terrains. And in the next video, you will see a person walking uphill with it. Another principle, so this is an overrunning, so there you cannot unlock it under load. While, for example, for the other locking mechanism in this foot, is that instead of using one big motor that has to work for a very short time during this peak of power burst, what we do is, and it's a bit similar with a crossbow, and with your muscles, you load a spring during a much longer time, but with less power, you lock it, and then you release it. But then, of course, the problem is how you can lock energy and unlock it with minimal amount of energy. The advantage is we could only do, it was only needed at one position, so like that we could work on a singular position with using a four-bar mechanism, where with a very small force, with a very small motor, and you can unlock that, and you can unlock a huge amount of energy. But you can only do it in one position, while with the overrun mechanism, you can start to lock it at different positions. So again, by using different needs for what your actuation requires, one or more locking principles becomes more optimal. And so since 1 year, this research from our group went to a spin-off company called Bionics, Axillus Bionics. So they had some challenges to find investments, but now they have sufficient investments, and they're evolving towards from a prototype that we developed in our lab towards a prototype for a commercial application, which of course requires much more development regarding different aspects. It's also a medical product, so they need the required certifications and so on, which they're currently working on. Then in the CyberLex project, which is a European project, we're also working on a prosthesis for above the knee. And there the requirements are completely different. So a knee requires, an ankle requires energy, a knee dissipates energy. And during stance phase, the knee behaves like a stiff spring where you have the weight acceptance. And during swing phase, it in fact has to dissipate energy in order to reduce the speed of the swing phase, so you don't hurt the knee during bring it in a stance phase in order to go towards a touchdown. So one way to do it is with a direct drive, but then you use 400 watts peak power and 160 joules per stride. You can also use a series elastic actuator, and then you have 200 watts per power needed and 100 joules per stride. But this peak loads a lot the motor. So what we did is we placed a parallel spring in it, and we took the motor kind of away from that load, because all the load is taken by this parallel spring. So this huge peak power is completely gone here. So that means that the series elastic actuator with a locking parallel spring now only uses 1/4 of the peak power, and also uses much more less energy per stride. So in fact, we don't need a motor there, but we still placed a motor there. And especially, for example, we participated in the Cybathlon. We tried again to participate this year, but due to Corona, it was all postponed. And yeah, if the person has to do this kind of motion set to lift from a very low IKEA chair, then it's of course very helpful to have a motor to do those kind of things. Of course, there the motor doesn't need to be so energy efficient. So we usually try to produce our actuators to be as efficient, energy efficient for the repetitive motions and only add energy where it's absolutely required. One innovation we also tried is, yeah, the knee dissipates energy, the ankle requires energy. So why can we not send, and that we did over wire energy from the knee to the ankle, but there we run into huge time issues. And so in the next versions, we abandoned that idea because it was at that time not feasible not yet find a good way to solve that timing issue in a mechanism. Here you see a Biomod exoskeleton where we used also a similar idea of parallel locking mechanisms to reduce it. So one thing that group members are also working on is to misalignment compensation mechanisms. And it's very challenging to align the joints of the human body with the joints of the robot. Moreover, that takes a lot of time. And so we worked on mechanism to do misalignment compensation automatically, which is, for example, here done in the Spexer exoskeleton. So then we also went a step further, and it was also inspired by the human body. We don't have one big muscle per joint. We in fact have a lot of muscle fibers for each joint. And that gives a lot of possibilities. The reason is, if you have only one actuator and it has to follow a certain trajectory, a certain torque and speed profile, yeah, then the energy efficiency is fixed. It's fixed on that energy efficiency map. But if you start to have more motors, then you can first of all do the constraint that you need to follow what is needed from an activation point of view. But the idea is also that you can distribute the power delivery over several motors with the overall objective to reduce the overall energy consumption. And so that was the idea in the ESC grant, where instead of one motor, you have multiple motors with every time locking mechanisms and springs. And that, for example, if you use the whole system like one motor, so all doing all the same, to lift a load and to move it in that position and then to come back, yeah, you require that blue amount of energy, and you see the four motors doing almost the same in power consumption. But then we did an optimization, and then for a certain trajectory, it calculated that all motors were needed to lift that weight, but then to keep it there, you could lock three of the four motors, because that was the big torque needed, and as such, the big currents needed to keep that load in that position. And that only one motor, which then the orange one, you see, you needed much more power to do that remaining motion. So that's a bit also inspired by the recruitment strategy that our muscles do. And when we lift something light, we use a few muscle fibers. When we lift something heavy, we use a lot, much more muscle fibers. And also the idea, for example, which you have in a Toyota Prius, where you want to optimize the energy efficiency by splitting the power coming from both an electric motor as a combustion engine. So how we can combine several motors in order to improve the energy efficiency, but also improve the dynamic range of the whole system. So this is by introducing redundancy. Of course, redundancy has also its challenges, because it's the complexity of the system increases a lot. And that, of course, is also from a mechanical point an issue. But I think with future production techniques, we can gradually improve that. And then, of course, one of the big
challenges... I'm sorry to interject, but we have just 1 minute left. So perhaps you want to just draw the big conclusions.
So... we're working then on stellar feeling mechanisms. So it's mechanisms in the material in order to stellar feel the material. So we're also working on multiple materials where we can have embodied design principles so that we can heal materials that have a lot of different stiffnesses to have much more similar complex designs. For those mechanisms, we still need heat, but soon we will also publish a paper where we can damage the part we take out of it and we can heal at room temperature like you see here, and then the actuator starts to work again. Of course, this is a damage at the part where they're not the stresses are reduced, but of course if you do more severe damage, like cutting completely a finger in two, then it takes for this material, for example, 7 days to heal. So as a conclusion, it's very important to completely use the actuator model. Also think of locking mechanism to unload the motor, redundant activation, and also we work on self-healing materials. So that's my presentation.
Thank you. Virtual round of applause. Thank you so much. Unfortunately, we don't have time for live questions anymore. I think an advantage of this format is that folks can type the questions in the Q&A. And then, Bram, if you could answer, that would be awesome. And the panelists also, I'm going to ask the panelists to type their questions over in the Q&A so that we can get all the answers there. So thank you. And